In this next video, we're going to look at the structure of a vertebrae. Here's some parts that we're going to look at on an actual image. So here's a vertebrae. Each vertebrae will have a body, which is a mass of bone, on the anterior end, and a spinous process coming out the posterior end. These are the bumps you feel on your back. There's also transverse processes at either side of the vertebrae. There'll be a vertebral foramen, which the spinal cord runs through. You'll have superior articular processes, and if I can see them, inferior articular processes, they're joint surfaces, so one vertebra can stack on top of another. We're going to look at the vertebrae. By the way, another pronunciation for the plural form of vertebra with an E is vertebrae. I choose to say vertebrae. You may have heard different pronunciations, but we're going to look at each portion of the spine separately. So let's start with cervical vertebrae. Of course, it's from C1 to C7. Spinous processes are bifid. We'll see that in a minute. And there are transverse foramen, which we'll see on the next slide. So what we mean by a bifid spinous process is, here's a spinous process. Notice how it splits in two? That happens often in cervical vertebrae, but nowhere else in the spine. Another key indication of a cervical vertebra is that the transverse processes have foramen. You see it here, and you see it there. So all seven cervical vertebrae from C1 to C7 have transverse foramina. No other vertebrae in the spine have that. Cervical vertebrae have two special cases, and that's the top two, C1 and C2, which we're going to refer to as atlas and axis. So atlas, C1, is special because it's the only vertebra in the entire spine that does not have a body. It's just a large foramen with no body. Of course, there's transverse foramina, like all cervicals have. If we look at C2, or axis, right here, it does have a body, but not only does it have a body, it has this extra projection of bone sticking up, which we call the dens, or sometimes the odontoid process, which means tooth, and it looks like a tooth. So C1 has no body, C2 has a body plus a dens. So in fact, it looks like C2, axis, took away Atlas's body for itself. And the reason why is now this big ring we call Atlas can pivot on this axis, specifically on the dens of the axis, so we can shake our head back left and right to form the movement that we know as no. Now we can distinguish thoracic vertebrae, there's 12 of them, T1 to T12, because they have ribs articulating with them. 12 pairs of ribs articulate with the 12 thoracic vertebrae, and their joint surfaces are called facets or demifacets, which are flat articular surfaces for the ribs. You can see facets, these flat joint surfaces on the, there's a demifacet on the thoracic vertebra. Another indication of thoracic vertebrae are that the spinous processes are long and they tend to point downwards. You can see a lot of downward pointing, although it doesn't show it too well in this picture. There's a lot of downward pointing spinous processes. Lumbar vertebrae from L1 to L5 don't have any special parts that other vertebrae don't have, like other regions that we went through. However, they are the largest of the vertebral regions. Their bodies are the thickest. Looking at a image here, you can see the further inferior we go, the larger the vertebral bodies. Spinous processes tend to be blunt, run straight back, almost like an axe, the head of an axe or a hatchet. And in the most inferior portion of the vertebral column, we have the sacrum, which is actually five bones that fuse into one bone, which have foramina for nerves to exit. L5 would be at the superior portion here. Your pelvic girdle would articulate with the lateral portions of the sacrum. And then at the inferior tip of the sacrum, I apologize, it cut off a bit on this video. However, you can see the whole thing in your textbook. We have the coccyx, which is the tailbone, which is completely cut off in this picture, but you can see most of it in these two images.